Hey guys, this is acservicetech, and today what we're going over is the top 8 reasons why an inducer motor on a natural gas or propane gas furnace does not seem to be working. The inducer motor's job is to actually push the exhaust gases out through the exhaust, and it actually sucks in the intake right from here through the heat exchanger and through the burner tube assemblies. So the inducer motor is the first thing that ends up being turned on by either the relays or the control board for the heat sequence to turn on. So this needs to turn on first, and then it's proven by a pressure switch. A pressure switch could look something like this or like this, but basically they are sensing the negative pressure coming from either the inducer motor housing or through a condensate drain in order to determine that this is actually working and that there's no clogs. Reason number one could be that the signal wire from the thermostat is not making it back to the control board in order for the control board to tell the inducer motor to turn on. So the way that we confirm if the control board is actually receiving the signal back from the thermostat is we have R coming to the thermostat and it connects to W, and then W comes back as the 24 volt wire. So this is the hot wire, and we can check it between white and common. So we have our multimeter set to volts AC, and right now we'll go ahead and check, and we see that we are reading nothing. So we got 0.033 volts, and we are set on heat, and the thermostat is calling. It says we want it set to 81, and it's 54 in the room, so it definitely should be calling at this point. You can see that we actually have 24 volts from R to C right here. And what should be happening is the R and W should be touching, and we should be getting 27 volts here, and we are not. In this case, you'd either have a problem with your thermostat itself or the thermostat wires. And the way to determine if it's the thermostat face is what you could do is take the face off and then jumper from W to R and see if you have the same problem. So if we jumpered from W to R, then that should tell heat to turn on. And the first thing that happens in the sequence of operation for the furnace is that the control board is going to send power to the inducer motor. So now we can go ahead and check our voltage. We can check from W to C, and you see that now we have 27 volts. That tells you that the thermostat face is the problem. If we actually took the face off and we jumpered inside the thermostat face from R to W, then you know that this was the problem. So if you don't have mag jumpers, what you could do is turn the power off, and then you could jump the R and the W together with a wire nut. And then you can go ahead and check inside your furnace at your control board for W to C. And you see that we have 27 volts right now. So this is problem number two. Once you've verified that you have 24 volts from W to C, and actually it's anywhere from 24 to 29 volts. So once you've verified that you have a signal calling for heat, you want to go ahead and check for your inducer motor wiring. You want to make sure that you are finding the right wires here and you're following it from the inducer motor back to the control board. In this case, I've already disconnected the wire and I have the probes in and I'm checking for voltage. So you see that the control board is not sending the 120 volts that it needs to the inducer motor. So in this case, this would actually be a board problem. Anytime you think it's a board problem, you want to make sure that you're not quick to condemn the board. It's actually one of these relays right in here that would end up closing, allowing the 120 volts to go through. But you know, there could be another issue such as a sensor or something like that, but in that case you'll notice that the blower motor does not want to turn off. So just make sure your limit sensors are working properly and that you don't have a low limit gas switch on a propane furnace, things like that, before you end up condemning the board. In reference to checking ECM variable speed inducer motors, what you need to do is actually access the troubleshooting guide for that model number furnace. And typically on the side right here, there's going to be a connector that you're going to have to check DC voltage readings off of. All right, so you're going to follow what the troubleshooting guide says from that manufacturer, and you're going to see the DC voltage values changing. Problem number three, what could happen is if you have a 120 volt or 240 volt inducer motor, and you have your capacitor could be bad. So this is actually a capacitor, this little block right here. So make sure that you have the power off. You're going to go ahead and disconnect the electrical connections off of there. You're going to go ahead and short out the terminals just like this. And this one says 3 UF and 250 volts. So we're going to go ahead and test this with a multimeter. We're going to turn this on to microfarads. So we're going to have to hit this select button. And then we're going to go ahead and check our microfarad reading. We're going to hold this in, and you want to give it possibly up to even, you know, 15 seconds or so, just in order to make sure that this is correct. So you see our reading right here is 2.3 UF. So this capacitor is actually more than 5% off. So you can replace this with a like stock capacitor that looks like this, a capacitor that's bigger that looks like this. The difference between these two is the voltage right here. This is 250 volts and this one's 370 volts and it has to do with how much insulation is inside the capacitor. You have to replace this 3 UF or 3 MFD with the same size. So this one won't work because this is a 5 MFD capacitor. But if you did have one that was, say, a 3 MFD that looked like this, you could replace this capacitor with it. This capacitor has to be installed on, typically it's brown wires, or one brown wire and one white wire, and it has to be in place for the motor to even be able to start up and also to run. So number four, the actual inducer motor bearings could be seized. So in this case, we can actually get into this shaft right here in order to try to spin it. And we see that that one's moving freely. But you can get into one and you can kind of feel it. It's really, really stuck. And once you get it spinning, then it seems to be working. A lot of times it's upon initial startup of the furnace for the first time in heating season. A lot other times it might just be in the middle of the heating season. You can tell this one is very easy in order to make sure that the inducer motor is spinning freely. On one such as this, once again, you just make sure the power is off and you can't get into here. So you just take your thermostat screwdriver and see if you can get it to spin that way. If you notice that a motor has actual ports on it for oil, those are not sealed bearings and those are the ones that end up needing to be oiled. If it ran out of oil and the bearings are seized, then the damage has already occurred and that would be one that you would end up recommending replacing. But how you add the oil in is you just go ahead and take this tube right here and you put it right into the hole, and then you go ahead and squeeze your zoom spout until you have this basically overflowing. You don't want to overflow a crazy amount, but you do want to get enough oil in to make sure that you have that whole reservoir filled up. So we should be pretty darn close right there. All right. Now, just so you know, just because you see these ports right here does not mean that this is a non-sealed bearing that needs to be oiled. You can actually look inside and there is no trough for the oil. And it actually says sealed ball bearings. So these outer casings of the inducer motor are made for a multitude of different model number blower motors. So this one happens to be one that has a sealed ball bearing, and make sure that you do not put any oil down inside that hole for sure. This is problem number five, and this inducer motor was out of a package unit. And you can see that this one has some play in it. It actually moves back and forth like this. And the problem with that was that the inducer wheel was binding on the edge by the heat exchanger. And that was a problem. And then the inducer motor was not turning on. It was actually just getting stuck. All right, so that's something that could happen. Or debris could be stuck in here, maybe from a bird's nest, and that's not allowing the motor to turn on. And this is problem number six. In this case, once again, the inducer motor is out of a package unit, and the problem with this one was that the inducer wheel actually has fallen off completely due to rot. All right, so it's rusting and just rotting the metal right there, and it's coming completely off. You could have something like this that's metal, but you can even have plastic ones where these actually all fall apart on the inside and then jam up the wheel, and then basically you need to replace this or replace the entire housing. So problem number seven could be that the inducer motor actually is running, but you're having some problem with proving that this is running with the pressure switch. So the sequence of operation for heat goes with the inducer motor turning on first, the pressure switch proving that the inducer motor is working and that there's no clogs, and then after that, the ignition source gets turned on. And what could be happening is this pressure switch could not be proving that this is operating, and I like to typically measure the pressure switch out with the SDMN6. All right, so this tool right here is very, very useful because you can actually isolate the pressure switch completely away from the system just to make sure that this is correct or not correct. As well, if you are going to go ahead and blow out these lines, make sure that you disconnect them from the pressure switch before you put any pressure on them. All right, so then you can blow these out. You could have a problem if the pressure switch tests good. You could have a problem if maybe your condensate trap for your 90% efficient furnace, maybe that's clogged, or maybe the drain piping is clogged, or maybe the tubing, like this tubing right here, is clogged, or maybe you have a clog in your exhaust or a clog in your intake. Possibly maybe the heat exchanger is clogged, and if that's the case, that's a very serious situation. You want to make sure that you go ahead and verify if that is clogged. And then problem number 8 could be that the actual inducer motor may be burnt out. So you could do a quick sniff test in order to smell if the windings are burnt out. And then in reference to testing it with resistance with your multimeter, you make sure that your furnace is off, you unplug the motor and unplug the capacitor, and your first check will be on ground. So you see I have my one probe in ground. You never put your test probes in this part because you don't want to oblong the connections. You always put them in the back part. So you can check right here, and we're checking for resistance values between ground and common. You see that we have none right there. OL, over limit. We see that we have right here on ground to hot, there's no problem. And just so you know, when you have the two wires going to the capacitor, the one that's brown and white, that one's actually touching the white wire inside of this 120 volt inducer motor right here. So we already tested the white, so we know that that is no problem. You see that we once again have OL, and we'll check this one anyway. And you see that we have OL. So we know that the windings did not short against the ground frame. And we can see that our ground is intact. Another way to do this is actually to try to take, you know, this is all painted, but you want to take your ground connection right here at your motor. The next test that we'll do is we'll just check the windings, and we'll go from common to hot. And you see that we have 34 ohms of resistance. We'll get the same reading if we go from hot to this capacitor wire with the white on it. Should have about 34 ohms of resistance. The other one said 34.7, this one says 34.6 ohms. And now we'll go ahead and check from hot to the other capacitor wire. And you see that we're reading 117 ohms. And now we'll go ahead and check from common to hot. Basically what we're making sure of is that we don't have 0.0 ohms of resistance and that we don't have OL, because OL would mean that the windings are burnt apart, and 0.0 ohms would mean that the windings are all melted together. And you see that we have 152.3 ohms. So this motor checks out good in reference to the resistance readings. If this inducer motor was bad, we would probably smell the burnt windings, and we'd probably also have a OL reading across the windings. And if you're looking for any of the tools and supplies used in this video, I have them all linked down in the description below. And if you want to help support this HVACR training channel, check out patreon.com/acservicetech, where we're rewarding the members there by adding extra content, such as articles, videos, and answering questions. So how Patreon works is supporters pledge to give $1, $3, $5, and up for every new HVACR video on the AC Service Tech YouTube channel. In return, I try to post extra articles and then some videos as well on that platform, just in order to say thanks and show my appreciation for their support. Hope you enjoyed yourself, and we'll see you next time at AC Service Tech Channel.